Hi friends, my name is Trish Roberts. So I wanted to just talk briefly about depression. I won't take much of your time, but there's a lot of people now today who have depression, and there's a number of reasons for that. One reason could be that we're living in a kind of a very topsy-turvy world, to say the least. Lots of violence and lots of social inequality. And if you're a person of color, that's increased greatly, that the pressures of the state against people of color, etc. There's all sorts of, there's all sorts of social inequality that's happening today that is quite frightening, really. And one could almost say that if one isn't depressed in one form or another, then I don't know, maybe you're not paying attention, or you're in a higher consciousness. Who knows? I don't know. But there's a lot of people today who are suffering from depression. So that's the first thing. And there are some people who have bouts of it. There are some people who have clinical depression. Now, I'm not a doctor. I was a registered nurse, but that's neither here nor there. I'm just going to share with you something that I read and I've been aware of for a while, and it's related to diet. And I think that people might find it very interesting, the links between inflammation and depression. And this is science-backed. But, there's some things that we can all do to address depression. There's meditation, there's getting involved in activities that benefit others. I think that's a really good thing to do. Sometimes there's a saying, if you want to be happy, be interested in other people's happiness, sort of try and benefit others, and that will make you happy. The more we focus in on ourselves, and what's wrong with us, and the more we feel discontented, the more that can, increase depression and also just feeling helpless. So, doing things for other people is a great thing, and getting involved in social activism, social justice, etc. And of course, exercise. And I'm speaking from experience, because I've had depression since I was in my teens. I'm part of the LGBT community, and so it was a little difficult at school. I'm a white person, so that's, I can probably be, I didn't have to deal with being a person of color, but in the 70s, when I was a teen, it wasn't much fun being part of the LGBT community and having to deal with the heteronormative sort of the prejudices, basically. So that possibly helped along my depression. But I went through a bit of a suicidal bout in my mid-teens. I didn't actually act on it, but it wasn't great. And so anyway, so I've had it since then, and it sort of was bad in my 30s, but then it kind of settled down in my 40s, and it's been quite good since then. And part of that is actually, I think, because I didn't expect this, but part of that, I think, was due to a change in my diet, which is related to when I became an ethical vegan. I wasn't even expecting that to happen, but in 2005, I became vegan. I saw a description of dairy online, and I was horrified and thought, well, if this is how dairy cows and calves are treated and eventually killed, I think I'm going to have to apply that. I'm sure that's happening in all sorts of other industries. And of course it was, it's just the nature of animal exploitation is abusive and also killing. So when I became vegan, which I consider for the right reasons, which is the ethical reason and why the term vegan was coined by Donald Watson in 1944. When I became vegan, I adopted a plant-based diet pretty much straight away, and then got rid of animal products from my life as fast as I could. But I noticed a, after about probably a year, I thought to myself, my goodness, my depression seems to have improved significantly. It was like a 50% improvement that I noticed. And it was something that I wasn't expecting at all. And I thought, and that was just something that I noticed and I thought, well, that's great. So, you know, and I'm going to read you something which I found on nutritionfacts.org, which is a science-backed site, which they investigate all the latest nutrition and medical journals and science journals for the latest in nutrition. And there's a very strong link between inflammation and depression. There were some other things I wanted to say too about how to, before I get into that, there were some other things I wanted to say about how to, you know, sort of deal with the depression when it waxes and wanes. Some people have it waxing and waning like I do. Other people might have it, you know, very seriously for a while and then it tapers off. Some people just have it serious the whole way through and they may require therapy and possibly even medication. I'm not anti-medication. There was a time when I was on medication for a while in the 90s, and that was quite beneficial for me when I was having a serious bout of it, which was kind of brought on a bit from a whole bunch of different life kind of life situations that happened all at once, and that kind of kicked me into a bit of a clinical depression there for a while. So, but there was a brief period of time where medication was very beneficial for me. That's my personal experience of it. So, but anyway, so there's people that have clinical depression, and that's and so for anyway for anybody who has depression, exercise is a really, now it's really hard for people sometimes when you're depressed. You probably, if you have depression, you probably know that. Wanting to go and do exercise, you might have the drive to do that, but actually getting up and getting, say, out to the driveway, it seems like it's the longest road imaginable. It seems like getting even just to the driveway to get onto the road, or if you live rurally like I do, it's a very long driveway. And then, you know, so sometimes that can seem almost it's a big obstacle, you know, but it's one of those things that it turns out that the more you do exercise, if you suffer from depression, in fact they've done studies where people who you know, I'm talking about just generally depressed people, not heavily clinically depressed, but they've noticed that it's almost as good as, say, Prozac. You know, having, say, at least an hour of exercise every day. But of course, as I said, when you're depressed, that can seem, even just getting out to the, you know, to the road can seem like some absolute, like traveling along the great wall of China or something. It just seems like this endless thing. So that's a tricky thing. But I personally find, like I do, at least an hour of sort of brisk walking every day along the river, and I find that incredibly beneficial. I sleep better, and it's just been very, very helpful to me. And I'll be getting more into, say, bike riding and stuff like that. It's really good around here to ride bikes, and you know, I try to do other things too. I spend probably too much time online doing social activism, but that's how I do vegan education online, because I live rurally. It's a bit isolated here, so it's online I get more access to people. So I do vegan education online, and I have a YouTube channel at Vegan Trove, which I do various live streams on social justice issues, anti-imperialism, anti-war, etc. That sometimes, you know, if you spend too much time online, I think social media can be really negative for one's mental health. So you sort of, it's good to limit one's, you know, time online. And there always seems to be sort of really unfortunate news coming through, basically. I mean, when you look at the news, it's not great. You know, it's very difficult to find anything that's happy or positive. I mean, you're not going to get oligarchs suddenly doing all the right things for people. That's something that's not going to happen. So unfortunately, you know, the news isn't great. So anyway, I find, you know, just sort of limiting social media can be really beneficial. I mean, they've even, I think it was even Facebook has kind of admitted that it's not great for one's mental health. You know, so there's that. And I find too, music is often, you know, I play the mandolin not very well, but I find, you know, you have to concentrate very much on what you're doing and you're not thinking about or worrying about different things. So you're concentrating on chords and whatever, and it really, really can take your mind away. And I also find doing arts very beneficial. But anyway, these are all, I'm sure you can probably think of things that will be beneficial for you. But like, I think if we're going to be doing social activism, it's really, really important that we try and look after our mental health and try and keep our spirits up and our, you know, and keep optimistic, because it's a marathon. It's not a sprint. There is change happening. You know, you can see change in relation to MMT taking off. I definitely in the last 10 years have seen change in relation to veganism taking off. I don't know who of you might be vegan in this that's viewing this live stream, but 10 years ago there was hardly anybody on social media talking about veganism. Really, it was like almost like a handful of us talking about ethical veganism, not promoting welfare, animal welfare, which is just torture for. It's just, if it was applied to humans, it'd be considered torture. I'm talking about real veganism. There was even the welfarists, there was hardly any people promoting welfare. So, you know, and in that 10 years, it's been, it's really taken off. So, you know, these things, you know, social justice movements, sometimes they can seem like they are very, very slow to begin with. And you think, oh God, this is going to take forever before it takes off. And it can be a bit sad. I, you know, and also you can, you know, you just have to keep going on. And then before you know it, suddenly there's this critical mass of people. And then suddenly it's just like this 100th monkey theory where it's popping up everywhere, all over the planet. And so take heart if there's a particular social justice issue that's beneficial for the planet. Take heart that, like, veganism is probably the least, you know, people, you know, everybody uses animals in one way or another, most people who aren't vegan, and it's like breathing for people. We don't think about using animals. It's something that we've been indoctrinated to believe it's good to do or it's fine to do. So the fact that veganism has taken off the way it has and it's really, really starting to take hold just shows that, you know, education, grassroots education works. So take heart if you're promoting, whether it's MMT or, you know, some other social justice issue, take heart that I'm sure that's probably it. At some point, you might think it's very, you know, it's going nowhere, and then suddenly just like it just sort of starts to people crop up everywhere, and then suddenly there it is. So, and the other things I wanted to suggest about depression too is, you know, it helps to eliminate intoxicants from your life. That can be tricky for some people, but, you know, that does help. And vitamin D is essential. Well, vitamin D for everybody today, because there's an epidemic of vitamin D deficiency today. So, And vitamin D has been strongly linked, deficiency has been strongly linked, and I'm talking about D for David, has been strongly linked to depression, to lots of other serious illnesses, cancer, diabetes, and so forth. So there are vegan vitamin Ds if you look for them. And I take, you know, about, I don't know, in winter I probably take about 5,000 units a day, which is 2,500 to 5,000 units a day, because we have like 8 hours a day of sunlight in winter here in Tasmania. It's not very much. But even people that get a lot of sun, they've discovered there's a lot of people today, particularly people with high levels of melanin in their skin, are susceptible to vitamin D deficiency. So that's really important. And the other thing is B12, and anybody who's vegan should take B12, because there's been so much sort of cleaning of vegetables. You know, B12 is a microbe that used to be on vegetables, and we used to eat them and get the B12 along with the vegetables. And it used to be in water, and that's been purified today. So vegans have to take B12, really. It's very important to take B12 because it reduces, otherwise you get a buildup of homocysteine in your blood, which thickens your blood, which can lead to strokes and heart attacks. So it's very important for vegans to take it, since everything's been kind of, you know, sort of purified and whatever, and vegetables cleaned, etc. But I would suggest other people take B12, you know, just the cheap medication over the counter stuff. That's a very important thing for everybody, really. So anyway, these are all things. Exercise is a really important thing, though. And as I said, it's incredibly difficult when you're depressed and when you're suffering from depression to actually get out. You know, it just seems like getting to the end of the driveway seems like a huge deal. But if you can do that, if you can sort of tell yourself, just do positive reinforcements in your head, and, you know, when you feel yourself going off into a negative sort of spins in your head about sort of negative thoughts about this and that, try and counter that with something positive. Because something about depression is, you know, one starts to have, you know, you can have feelings, you can have all these sort of negative thoughts that can keep recycling in one's head. And, you know, and that, of course, just kind of doesn't, it just helps keep it going too. So there's all sorts of different things we can do. And, you know, there's plenty of information online of how to address that. But the thing I wanted to talk about now is, and don't forget meditation. I think meditation is very beneficial for so many things, you know, because we're like little projectors, really. We go around the world projecting our own sort of thoughts and experiences onto everything. You know, we talk to people and we might have a little dialogue going on in our head about things, about them, or maybe their appearance, or, you know, or they remind us of someone, and we've got this little sort of movie going on that we're projecting onto them rather than actually being there, being in the present moment, which is something that it's very difficult for in this modern day to keep in the present moment. And yet being in the present moment is sort of takes away, you're not concerned about the future, you're not concerned about the past, you're in the present moment and you're meeting people in the present moment, and you can see a lot more clearly what's actually going on before you, rather than playing this movie and projecting this movie onto people, which we all do. You know, we all do it. We all project. We're carrying around a lot of prejudices and biases and all sorts of things. We sort of put that onto others instead of meeting them as they appear in front of us, and sort of not carrying these preconceptions with us. So being in the present moment, that meditation helps with that. And it also stops out the rattling on of our mind. You know, we're constantly going these little stories in our head all day. And when you do meditation, you become aware of those little chattering stories. It doesn't mean, that it suddenly stops. But when you sit and you become aware of those chattering stories, you see how much the sort of things that are going on in your head, and it becomes much clearer. It becomes much clearer. You become more aware of how you are and what you're thinking, and it sort of calms the mind, and then you can kind of deal with things in the present moment. And that really helps for people who have depression, because anxiety is something that's often associated with depression. It can be social anxiety when we have you know, so when we're meeting people, and if you suffer from depression, sometimes being in social situations can be very anxiety provoking. And so meditation really helps with that. And all these other things I mentioned, exercise and everything, helps reduce. And, you know, there is also some herbal sort of alternatives too, which you can, if you're really suffering from depression, and I'm not talking about weed, but if people want to do that, that's great. That's fine too, whatever. But it's, I'm talking about, you know, sort of there's hops and there's all sorts of different things that if you're having trouble sleeping, if exercise isn't helping you in your daily sleep, you know, there's non-habit forming things that you can use that are available that are herbal and stuff. But exercise can do the trick, I think, if you do some good exercise. Anyway, so these are all things, you know, I'm no expert at this, but these are just speaking from experience as someone who's had depression since they were a teen. You know, and at one stage it was quite bad. You know, these are all things that I found to be helpful. And anyway, so as I said, the link between inflammation and depression is quite a strong one. So I'm going to share with you this. It's about five paragraphs, and I think you might find it very interesting. It's from nutritionfacts.org, which is, as I said, is a science-backed. It scans all the latest medical science and health journals, nutrition journals, and it gets the latest research on it. So let me just check the comment section. I don't often check while I'm trying to talk. I don't often check the comment section, which I probably should, but then I get really, oh yes, that's right, Michelle. Turmeric actually is very beneficial, and apparently saffron, except saffron is quite expensive, but yeah, turmeric. Let's see, and getting out in nature, absolutely. That's right, Douglas. There's certainly, I think, you know, when people have serious, you know, clinical depression, as I mentioned, I found that medication actually at one point was very beneficial for me. And if you get into women, when they get into menopause, that sometimes the it can get depression can be more pronounced, or excuse me, older people, serotonin levels actually decrease in your brain when you get into sort of advanced years. And so that's also tricky, but it's something to be aware of, because if you start to feel that way, you know, you can sort of maybe just sort of talk to your doctor or whatever, or take some action. But this, I think what I'm going to suggest, what I'm going to read to you now, please keep this in mind, because I think this could be very, very beneficial for people. Okay, and I will check the other comment section. I'll check the comment section after, and I'll answer some of these questions. Let's see. Oh, and the other important thing that is very important for anybody with depression is to make sure that isolation is something that you can be self. It can, when you're depressed, you can have a sort of anxiety about being in social situations, and that of course can make you feel you try and avoid it, and then you become after a while you become a bit isolated. And of course isolation, you know, there's studies where older people, you know, when they get isolated, you know, they end up sort of going right off, you know, sort of health-wise and everything. Isolation, we're just primates, we're just primates, and we need to have social input from other human beings or from non-human animals if we live with non-human animals. You know, that's a wonderful thing. I get so much happiness. I'm fortunate enough to have a wonderful partner, but I also live with some non-human animals that are just wonderful. They're rescues, and just even seeing them makes me incredibly happy. Just seeing the wonderfulness of, as a vegan, I've come to appreciate non-human animals so much more than I ever did. And they're just, you know, I mean, we're so fortunate to be sharing the planet, and that's why it's so sad that we're exploiting them and eating, wearing, and using them. So I encourage people to really think seriously about becoming vegan and check out my podcast, howtogovegan.org. It's a podcast. You can listen to it when you're walking or whatever. And I think you might find there's some very convincing material in there about why we should be vegan. Okay, so I'm going to share this now, this nutritionfacts.org thing about depression. And I think you might find some interesting information in it. So depression affects more than 150 million people worldwide, making it a leading cause of losing healthy years of life as a result of disability. In fact, by 2020, depression may be the second leading cause of healthy years of life lost, second only to heart disease. Why is depression so common? Well, it is said, quote, "Nothing in biology makes sense except in the light of evolution," end quote. But why would we evolve to get depressed? Depression poses a baffling evolutionary puzzle. It has such negative effects, but remains so common and heritable, meaning a big chunk of risk is passed down through our genes. So there must be some kind of adaptive benefit. Otherwise, presumably, it would have been naturally selected against. Maybe depression is an evolutionary strategy for defense against infection. Infection has been the leading cause of mortality throughout human history. The average life expectancy was 25, and it was not uncommon for half our kids to die. With such stark capabilities, infection has been a critical and potent driving force in natural selection. When we become infected, there is a surge of inflammation as our body mounts a counterattack, and then what happens? We feel lousy, we feel sick, we get weak, tired, slow, and sleepy. We don't see anyone, we don't want to do anything, all we want to do is sleep. It's like we're depressed, and that's great for fighting infection. Not only does that help us conserve energy so we can put up a good fight, but it reduces social contact. We're not running around infecting everyone. It's the same reason we evolved to think poop doesn't smell good or decaying flesh. That keeps us safe from infection. In fact, we see this phenomenon with other social animals, like honeybees and mole rats, who feel impelled to crawl off and die alone when they get sick, which reduces the risk to the rest of the community. The relationship between mental health and inflammation was first noted in 1887, for which the only psychiatrist to ever win the award got a Nobel Prize. But what evidence have we accumulated in the centuries since that inflammation causes depression? Well, people who are depressed have raised inflammatory markers such as C-reactive protein, and inflammatory illnesses are associated with in greater rates of major depression. Indeed, that's what's found in a variety of inflammatory conditions, including more benign inflammatory conditions such as asthma and allergies. And that's important, suggesting the mood symptoms are not simply, quote, feeling bad about having a terrible disease, end quote, but may be directly tied to the inflammation. Most powerfully, you can actually induce depression by inducing inflammation, like when we give interferon for certain cancers or chronic infections. Up to 50% go on to suffer major depression. Even just giving a vaccine can cause enough inflammation to trigger depressive symptoms. Taken together, these studies are strongly suggestive of inflammation being a causative factor of mood symptoms. So can an anti-inflammatory diet help prevent depression? We didn't know until about 43,000 women without depression were followed along with their diets for about a dozen years to see who became depressed. And it was those who ate a more inflammatory dietary pattern characterized by more soda, refined grains, and meat, suggesting that chronic inflammation may underlie the association between diet and depression. Normally we think of omega-3s as anti-inflammatory, but they found fish to be pro-inflammatory, associated with increased C-reactive protein levels, consistent with recent findings that omega-3s don't seem to help with either depression or inflammation. And I just wanted to add in there that you can get omega-3s that are seaweed-based, and as a vegan, they do suggest to take because as we get older, our body actually has difficulty making these long-chain fatty acids. They have trouble converting things into the correct what we require for our body. So we actually sometimes need to supplement omega-3s, and you can get seaweed omega-3s. But I'll leave a link to that. I didn't explain that very well. But yeah, that's something to think about. The most anti-inflammatory diet is a plant-based diet, which can cut C-reactive protein levels by 30% within 2 weeks, perhaps because of the anti-inflammatory properties of antioxidants. I've talked before about this, but never explained why antioxidants are anti-inflammatory. Oxidative damage caused by free radicals may cause an autoimmune response in the body by changing the chemical structure of otherwise ubiquitous molecules to generate new structures that the body attacks as foreign. For example, when LDL cholesterol gets oxidized, our body creates antibodies against it and attacks it. And so clinical depression can be accompanied by increased oxidative stress and the autoimmune inflammatory responses it creates. Where else does inflammation come from in our diet? Endotoxins. Excuse me. And I've talked about endotoxins before, which is really amazing. I'll leave a link to just a video just about endotoxins and how when we eat animal products, we immediately get an inflammatory response in our body. And so our body in some ways is constantly it's constantly suffering from inflammation. So that's a very interesting thing about products, animal products, and depression. So endotoxins. It's worth reviewing how the endotoxins in animal products can cause a burst of inflammation within hours of consumption. What does that do to our mood? If you inject endotoxin into people within a few hours, an inflammation shoots up, and so do feelings of depression, as well as feelings of social disconnection from people. Although previous research has demonstrated that inflammatory activity contributes to depressive symptoms, no work in humans has examined the effects of experimentally induced inflammation on anhedonia, the lack of reaction to pleasurable stimuli, a key diagnostic feature of depression. I don't know if you do get depression, you probably know what that feels like, and anhedonia, which is a lack of reaction to pleasurable stimuli. That can be very, very distressing when somebody is seriously depressed, not actually feeling any sort of feelings of joy and whatever, you know, and the chemical imbalances can be, you know, really serious when people are seriously depressed. So anyway, no work has been done. That is, until now, this is in relation to anhedonia. Within hours of endotoxin hitting the bloodstream, these experimental subjects not only started to feel depressed, but they had significant reductions in activity in the reward center of their brain. They were less excited about winning money, playing video games, for example, in the study. But by eliminating animal products and eating antioxidant-rich diets, we may be able to prevent or treat depression. So anyway, I'll leave a link to that particular article by Dr. Grieger on nutritionfacts.org, and I invite you to check that out. So really, that's really all I wanted to talk about. I think, you know, I've been around long enough and had depression for long enough that I sort of feel like I have a little bit of insight into it. Of course, everybody's different. We're all different. And everybody has different ways of dealing with things. Everybody's had different life experiences. Some people have been abused in their life. They've been, some people have even been tortured. I mean, if you're Palestinian, you probably, if you're not seriously depressed living in the apartheid state of Israel, then you're some sort of superhuman, and suicide is very common, you know, because it's such a dreadful situation, particularly in Gaza for Palestinians. So, you know, I mean, you know, there are people who have incredible challenges psychologically, particularly children who live in these kinds of awful situations. And there's challenges in the West too, with, you know, the way governments are becoming more and more oppressive and fascistic, I guess you could say. And that's sort of disturbing because it causes great insecurity with people, and, you know, with job insecurity and all that kind of thing. And that's where MMT comes in. That's why that's a very important issue. And I'm sure if you are normally on this page, you've probably seen a number of videos about MMT. And I'm trying to influence some politicians down here and some groups about MMT, because it's very, very important for addressing the public purpose. Anyway, so that's really all I wanted to say. I hope that there's some little, you know, something in it for you somewhere. I definitely have to say that, and I did not expect this when I became vegan. And as I said, I became vegan for ethical reasons, for non-human animals, because I don't want to exploit them anymore. They're sentient. But I did notice after about a year that my depression had improved like 50%. And then when I sort of really was able to incorporate exercise into everything, and the other things that I mentioned, vitamin D, B12, you know, sort of spending less time on social media, and also doing social justice stuff, thinking about others, you know, thinking about others is really important. It, you know, if we spend all our time, you know, thinking about ourselves and what's wrong with ourselves, and yet there are people like Palestinians or, you know, children in Yemen dying of disease and famine due to the West and our Western imperialism, things like that. If we start to think about others and think about people as a global community, and that non-human animals and human animals, we're all interconnected, we're sentient, we all love life and we don't want to die. If we start thinking as a global community and include non-human animals, become vegan and include non-human animals in our way of thinking, and refuse to exploit, then we will all be happier. It's a win-win for all of us. So anyway, depression is on the rise, suicide is on the rise, and we have to do what we can. Justice and nonviolence is something that we need more of in the world. And when we have more justice and more nonviolence in the world and social equity, and when we have a vegan world, I think there will be a lot less depression, because at the present time, I think it's untenable for mental health. That's what I personally think, the way the world is at the moment. It is not conducive to mental health, because it's functioning in a very, very dysfunctional way. And I don't think that human beings are supposed to be trying to survive mentally in such a dysfunctional sort of a situation as we have now, with all the social inequality and the poverty, et cetera, and the violence. So we all have to do something to change that. We all have to be peace, and we all have to promote peace. And one of the ways we can be peace is to go vegan and stop exploiting animals, and also think about other fellow human beings and what their plight is, because we're responsible for their plight. And that includes people like Julian Assange. Think about Julian Assange, locked in that embassy for 6 years. And if we don't call out to have his safe return to a safe country, then we're sabotaging ourselves. Everything that happens to everybody in some ways is going to affect us. You know, it all affects us. Everything that happens affects us in some way. Anyway, so thanks so much for watching. I hope that if you have depression, that you think about some of these things. And if you have serious depression, or if you're feeling suicidal, please think about you know, if you can, talking to someone, get in touch with, there are various, you know, sort of helplines, and I encourage people to do that, because suicide, feeling suicidal doesn't, is not something that, when you're, if you're suicidal, it doesn't sort of go on ad infinitum usually. It actually, I remember one time my therapist said to me, because I went through a time where I was feeling suicidal and it was very chemical. And she would say to me sometimes, and see, I'm fortunate enough I was able to get therapy. There are people in the United States cannot do that. It's too expensive. In Australia, we had a better health system than we have now, but I was able to get therapy for free in the 90s. And my therapist said to me, she said, look, why don't you wait and see how you feel in a week, you know? And it turned out that in a week I felt quite different to that day when I was feeling awful, you know, and I had a suicidal ideation. It changes from day to day. And that's the thing to remember when you're feeling dreadful and you think, you know, I don't think I can be here anymore. Just remember that that's probably not going to be like that in, say, a week. And, you know, it changes. And reach out to somebody close, or if you don't have somebody close, please call helplines and talk to people, because we need you here. You know, you're the only one in the world that's like you. You know, you are completely unique in the universe. There's nobody like you. And you have everything that is beautiful inside you. You may feel awful. You may feel useless and worthless, but you're not. Everything that is beautiful is inside you, and we need you here. So look after yourself, be kind to yourself, and find some support, get some help, and talk to people. And, you know, I just want you to think of that. If ever you're feeling any sort of suicidal ideations, reach out and get some support. Just know that you may feel awful about yourself. You may think you're worthless, but you are a unique individual on this planet. And if you left us, we would never experience that uniqueness again. So you are very important to all of us to be here. Okay, so anyway, that's all I wanted to say. So my best to you, and may you have every happiness that you wish, and may the world have peace and love. Love is very important today, peace and love and kindness and justice. Okay, thanks so much for watching. My name's Trish Roberts. If you want to join my YouTube channel, it's at Vegan Trove, VEGANTROVE on YouTube. And I talk about a whole different range of topics, social justice and veganism. So feel free to subscribe to my channel. Okay, thanks so much. Have a great day. Bye for now.